There is a new building looking out at the skyline of Miami. Marlins Park. A state-of-the-art stadium with a vast roof that ensures the Miami Marlins can play baseball during heat waves and storms. But this stadium is built for more than spectator comfort. This stadium is built to survive some of the worst weather on the planet.
Miami and South Florida are the most likely place to get a hurricane in the United States.
The city can be battered by destructive winds, flood surges, and lethal debris. And of all structures, roofs are in the greatest danger.
The roof had flown off in one piece and smashed into the neighbor's house.
Designers faced an almost impossible challenge to build a gigantic roof that could survive a hurricane.
I don't know that I trusted them in the beginning because it sounded so crazy to me. These are the best engineers in the world. They turned out to be exactly right.
So how did Miami designers engineer their new stadium to be indestructible? Nature can unleash some of the most destructive forces on the planet. But around the world, engineers are fighting back, determined to build structures that can survive the worst, that are bigger, higher, and stronger than ever before. How do they do it? Discover the secrets behind engineering the impossible, building indestructible megastructures. Miami, home to over 400,000 people, is the largest urbanized area in Florida. And its unique situation, reaching out into the warm waters of the Atlantic Ocean, give it a subtropical climate that is unlike any other city in the US. Summer temperatures here go from hot to hotter, and only cool when a thunderstorm strikes. So when the Miami Marlins baseball team needed a new stadium, they knew it would have to be designed to deal with Miami's unique weather.
The weather here in Miami is hot and wet, really starting in April and lasting all the way through October, which happens to be the baseball season. So it's been that way forever, and that's what makes it paradise.
But the heat, humidity, and frequent storms can make watching baseball in Miami an unpleasant experience. The Marlins wanted a stadium that could keep 37,000 fans comfortable throughout a 7-hour ball game. The stadium needed air conditioning. Designers calculated they would need 358 vents around the building to keep it cool.
My favorite part of this ballpark are the air conditioning ducts. They're huge. You could fit a circus animal in them.
12,800 gallons of chilled water pumped through these ducts every minute, cooling the whole stadium to just 75 degrees Fahrenheit. But designers still had to deal with Miami's frequent storms, deluges that could delay games or stop them completely. The stadium needed a roof that would retain the cool air and stop games from being delayed or abandoned during thunderstorms. But there was one very good reason why a traditional roof would not be an option. Top-level baseball players need a top-quality playing field, and that means natural grass. Natural grass requires natural light and rain on the field. So the designers planned a roof that could slide back and forth, a retractable roof. This would be a stadium that could respond to the weather. To cover the entire field, they planned a colossal roof with a surface area of more than 330,000 square feet. To save space when closed, the roof would be split into three separate panels, one big and two small. These panels would then stack under each other, reducing the coverage of the retracted roof by a third. And this roof didn't just have to be big, it had to be high. For Aaron White, the engineer charged with designing the roof, the height was a problem.
When designing the roof, we want to minimize the roof height as much as we can to minimize the exposure to wind. Every foot we increase the roof just creates more and more wind pressure that we have to resist.
Looks like something out of the future, doesn't it?
The higher the roof, the more danger it's in from the wind. But baseball batters can hit the ball up to 200 feet into the air.
Oh, what a shot!
We have to respect the game that's going on inside of the stadium, and so we need to raise the roof up for that.
Aaron and his team had to strike a balance. A roof that clears balls destined to be home runs, but as low as possible to reduce wind pressure.
When we did our analysis, we found that the roof actually needed to be highest right over second base.
Above second base is the only area that Aaron needed to give full clearance to the ball players.
We actually utilized the layout of the three-panel roof, knowing that the upper panel was going to be over the middle of the playing field.
Aaron exploited the fact that the roof is made up of three panels. Only one of these would have to be curved up to 210 feet out of the way of the flying baseballs. The other two panels could be lower to protect them from the wind as much as possible. The Marlins can play ball under this roof, but the team calculated they would need the roof to be closed for 3% of the year. The rest of the time, it needed to be out of the way of the field so it could get enough sunlight to grow the grass. But the huge tracks that held the roof so high threw shadows on the field below. The designers had to find a way to guarantee that the whole field would get a full 6.5 hours of sunlight each day.
On the south side, due to the orientation of the stadium here, we want to get more sun down onto the grass to grow the playing field. So we actually lowered the south side by about 40 feet. We're actually tilting the stadium towards the sun.
Marlins Park was already shaping up to be a technological masterpiece, but the engineers were facing an even greater challenge. The roof could bring in the sun and protect the game from thunderstorms, but Florida's frequent hurricanes presented a problem of terrifying proportions. Hurricanes on the southeast coast can destroy a building in a number of ways. Winds reaching up to 200 miles per hour can hurl lethal debris like shrapnel and send storm surges that can flood the land with ocean water, bringing chaos right into downtown Miami. For the engineers, it seemed an impossible challenge. They proposed a spectacular stadium that would keep the spectators in total comfort, allow natural light onto the playing surface, and withstand the worst storms nature could throw at it. And the innovation started right at the bottom, beneath the waterlogged ground of Miami. All construction in Miami faces one big problem. Just a few feet below the ground, the earth gives way to water, making subterranean building almost impossible. Sid Perkins was the construction manager charged with building the foundations in this saturated ground.
Foundations carry every bit of weight. You start at the very roof, the top structure, and all that weight has to be passed down and dispersed throughout the ground. Concrete is the key to every foundation. Even if you have a steel building, it all comes back to a concrete foundation.
And Sid should know. He's built stadiums across the U.S. But in Miami, the earth is so waterlogged. Concrete would simply dissolve before it had time to set.
It's very difficult because the water at that level, it would have separated the cement from the aggregate and would have reduced the strength of the concrete.
Using normal construction methods would put the whole structure at risk. Sid had to make sure the concrete would hold the weight of the roof. First, they drilled a series of 18-inch piles into the ground, driving through the waterlogged soil all the way to the solid limestone bedrock 100 feet down. As they poured 1,000 cubic yards of concrete to support the building, they had to constantly pump out water to allow the concrete to set. If the concrete became contaminated by water at any point, the whole structure would be rendered useless.
These are the toughest columns I've poured in a 40-year-plus career.
To stay strong, this stadium needed brilliant engineering solutions hundreds of feet below the ground. Because above ground level, this building would face some of the most destructive forces on the planet. And it would have to face them time and time again.
On average, a hurricane comes along in Miami every 2 or 3 years. We wait around, Miami's getting another hurricane. If you look over a long period of time, 100 years or 150 years, Miami and South Florida are the most likely place to get a hurricane in the United States.
In the heart of residential Miami, engineers faced a seemingly impossible challenge. The Miami Marlins wanted their 37,000 capacity stadium to be covered so that fans could enjoy air conditioning on sweltering game days. But the Florida coast is hurricane central, and the power of a hurricane coming right off the warm Atlantic waters can devastate even the biggest buildings. This constant threat often starts on the other side of the Atlantic.
It generally happens that you have a thunderstorm complex that's big over Africa, moves out into the Atlantic. So the air is rising up over the tropical waters, and it starts pulling in air at the bottom because it's like suction. It's sucking up from the ocean surface. The more warm water, the more energy it has.
Meteorologists can forecast a hurricane 36 hours before it arrives in Florida, but they can't predict exactly where it's going to land.
Hurricanes generally take two kinds of tracks. One is they go kind of west toward the Gulf. The other is they curve north up into the ocean or up the East Coast. And where that fork is, if you take that fork straight, that's right at Miami.
This is why Florida is the state most frequently hit by hurricanes. And Miami reaches right out into the water that powers the monster storms. At Marlins Park, the foundations are in place. And as soon as the build team started on the stadium above, they were in a race against time, because every hurricane season could bring disaster for the construction workers and the nearby residents. To reduce risk, they needed to complete the project as fast as possible. Construction manager Pat Delano came up with a solution.
When we first looked at the project, we looked at it as two projects. One was building the ballpark bowl, and the second was to build the tracks that the retractable roof will roll on.
By treating construction of the stadium bowl and the roof as entirely separate projects, Pat could now build the two structures at the same time. The plan would knock months off the building schedule and reduce the exposure to potentially deadly hurricane seasons. The key was to first build the support tracks for the retractable roof, but normal construction methods were not an option.
The traditional approach would be using scaffolding. We'd form the track beams up on top of the scaffolding, we'd pour all the concrete, put all the other plumbing, electrical up in 150 feet in the air.
But traditional scaffold supports would halt any building work beneath until they were removed. There had to be a better way. Pat Delano turned to bridge builders for a solution.
Our alternative method to building the track beams was we formed the track beams on the ground, we put all of our mechanical, electrical, plumbing in those track beams while they're on the ground.
By constructing the finished trackways on the ground, then hoisting them into place, Pat freed up space to construct the stadium bowl beneath.
And it worked great for us. Also, we saved time. We've saved 3 to 4 months.
Pat had shaved an entire hurricane season off the schedule, and in fact, avoided a serious storm. The elevated trackways would soon support the giant roof. But at 8,300 tons, the roof would weigh more than the Eiffel Tower. How could you move such a weight?
Okay. All right,
Andrew Augusto and the engineers at Marlins Park turned the sheer weight of the steel roof to their advantage.
This system is a friction drive system, so you have a flat wheel, 36-inch diameter steel wheel, that's rolling on a rail. It's steel on steel.
Because these flat steel wheels don't have any natural grip, the system relies on friction.
It all works based on the weight of the structure itself. It's part of the steel structure. And because we know what that is, we know that these wheels aren't going to spin. It's plenty heavy, even under higher winds.
The sheer weight would stop the wheels slipping. But driving the mammoth structure along the trackway would require a heavy-duty motorized system and state-of-the-art technology to control it.
Right now, we have 44 transporters that are all powered by over 760 horsepower, 3 separate panels that move simultaneously.
And the power needed to be evenly distributed across each roof panel.
80 10-horsepower motors power this roof, this big gear motor. That is where all the energy is coming from.
Having 80 small motors was the best way to ensure that the 3 panels each moved at the correct speed. When the roof was in motion, the wind at this height is unpredictable. Andrew needed to make sure that each panel received exactly the right amount of power, even when the wind was pushing and pulling them at different rates. The answer was found in state-of-the-art electronics.
It's controlled by what are called VFDs, variable frequency drives, and they're enclosed in these bins here. Each transporter has one of those. And what that does is it controls the power as the panels are moving so that it can adjust itself, it can adjust its speeds based on winds, based on thermal expansion, contraction, things like that.
This brilliant electronic solution is the brain of the roof. Each motor knows what every other motor is doing. And that means that the transporters powering the roof can individually slow down or speed up to compensate for the wind. The result is that you get a perfect move every time. The design is so effective that the Marlins Park roof will travel around 2,000 miles in its lifetime. That's almost the distance from London to Cairo. But when this roof is in place over the field, it acts like a giant sail. And in Miami's almost daily thunderstorms, this is a very real hazard. How could the engineers make sure that the roof would survive Miami's extreme weather? The answer? Design the building to change with the weather. Its futuristic design has a roof that closes to shield people from the stifling Miami summers, but can open to allow the elements to feed the precious Marlins playing field. However, when the roof is closed and all three panels are exposed to the elements, they start to behave like a sail. Even moderate thunderstorms will push and pull the roof in all directions. The engineers needed to make sure these stresses wouldn't damage their creation.
Well, in most cases, when you have a structure, you feel like it should be rigid, but if it doesn't move, it's going to generate load. It starts putting force on your wheels, starts putting force on your rails, makes things wear faster, and all that load has to go to the ground, and it's not necessary.
Andrew Agosto and his team found the solution in nature. The key was to design a structure that wouldn't try to resist the wind, but would flex with it. But could they, though, build roof trusses that were rigid and flexible?
So the truss is much like a normal one, which you would get in a fixed structure, but it's connected to hinges at the top of these stilts or columns. So it has two spherical hinges at the top of each truss. From there, it connects to the column, and the column transfers that load down to the transporter where there's another set of hinges. And all together, you have hinges up top, hinges on the bottom, and they can sway.
Using this four-bar hinge system allows the closed roof to sway by 2.5 feet in the wind, dissipating the wind load. This roof can flex and sway to save itself in a thunderstorm, but the weather in Miami gets far more extreme. Hurricane strength winds could destroy this meticulous engineering and turn the biggest retractable roof in Florida into the most lethal. And the citizens of Miami know this only too well, because in 1992, Hurricane Andrew showed them exactly what nature could throw at them. The storm caused $26 billion of damage and destroyed 25,000 homes. It was a Category 5 hurricane, one of only three that have ever hit the US, with winds exceeding 157 miles per hour, blasting South Miami.
We can hear things start to fly around up there. I'm sure we're approaching hurricane force winds.
When Hurricane Andrew struck, Stan Goldenberg took refuge in his home.
You can hear that outside.
In total, there were 9 people sheltering in the house, including 6 children.
We didn't have any indoor windowless room, so we picked the hallway, we kind of barricaded ourselves in.
We are praying God will cover that.
But as the storm picked up, it became clear Stan's family was still not safe.
Then the board started to rip off the windows. The hurricane started roaring through the house. The roof had flown off in one piece, flew over our fence and smashed into the neighbor's house.
While Stan's house was being torn apart in front of his eyes, he was struggling to find a safer place for his family as they took refuge in the kitchen.
We were stuck in the kitchen, and I honestly have never heard anybody take refuge in the kitchen, but we were not about to go back, because it's just getting worse and worse.
As the storm reached its maximum ferocity, the family were trapped in the tiny space.
We were just crying out for mercy. I mean, we didn't know if we would get out of there alive.
When the wind and noise finally died down, Stan went outside to inspect the damage.
Thanking God that we were all safe. Hallelujah.
In the morning light, and I remember really seeing my house for the first time, and it was like, whoa.
The roof lifted off.
There was hardly any walls left of my house. Again, the roof was gone.
Hurricane Andrew was the costliest hurricane of the 20th century. And if it stripped the roof off Stan Goldenberg's house, the Marlin Park engineers can imagine only too well what a hurricane could do to the biggest retractable roof in Florida. The latest addition to Miami's skyline, Marlins Park, is a meticulously engineered work of art. It is able to accommodate 37,000 fans in style. That's almost a tenth of Miami's population. A vast retractable roof allows fans to enjoy the game in air-conditioned comfort on scorching days and keeps Florida's frequent thunderstorms from delaying play. On game day, the three panels of the roof move to precise locations over the field. They seal together, making one fixed roof that blocks out the elements. Come rain or shine, the Marlins are going to play ball with at least 81 home games a year. But Florida's weather reaches even greater extremes. Hurricanes hit this coastline more often than anywhere else in the U.S. 114 hurricanes have hit Florida since records began. And Miami is right in the firing line. In 1992, Hurricane Andrew showed the citizens of Miami exactly what a hurricane could do to their homes. The engineers of Marlins Park are building the biggest retractable roof in Miami. How could they secure it against such a ferocious attack? The winds of a hurricane have an unexpected effect on a roof the size of Marlins Park. It doesn't push the roof sideways, it lifts it up into the air. As wind travels over the stadium, it creates low pressure above the roof, sucking it upwards. It's the same principle that causes an airplane wing to generate lift. The biggest danger the engineers had to deal with wasn't it falling down, but rather it flying up. To combat this, the designers tried to prevent the wind from running over the roof.
One of the key architectural features that actually impacts the wind load in a positive way is the cornice up here above the operable window on the east side of the stadium. You can see it sticks out about 12 feet or so. And what it does is it really serves to channel the wind around the stadium rather than over the stadium. So wind that's coming from the east crashes into the window here. The cornice prevents it from running up over top, and it actually runs around here. During construction, or during the design process actually, the contractor said, well, that's a really difficult cornice for us to put into place. Can we get rid of it? And we said, no, you don't want to do that. That's going to really increase the pressures that the roof experiences and what we're designing for.
The cornice reaches out over the edge of the building and channels the wind around the sides, preventing some wind from running over the roof. But this alone is not enough to keep the roof on during a hurricane. Because this roof is made of three panels, there is an area of weakness between each section that the wind could exploit.
For the retractable roof, you have the chance of a breach at the seal location. So we can see the seals down here on the right-hand side. Those seals are not hurricane-proof. So in a massive windstorm, they may blow off, they may get damaged.
If hurricane winds break the seals and get inside the stadium, they will push up on the roof from below. Added to low pressure sucking the roof upwards, this could cause the roof to go flying through the air.
If you have a big enough opening, it'll actually blow up almost like a balloon on the inside.
The solution was radical. It was the equivalent of leaving a window open in the middle of a hurricane, something that club president David Sampson thought would put the stadium in danger.
The engineers said, trust us. I don't know that I trusted them in the beginning because it sounded so crazy to me.
Instead of trying to fight the wind, sealing the gaps and preventing leakage, the engineers did exactly the opposite. They called the solution hurricane mode.
We developed this position here to create gaps all around the stadium. So in between the east and upper panels here and the upper and west panels, and then even the west panel and the fixed panel on the far side.
Instead of trying to seal the roof in a hurricane, it's kept slightly open with gaps between the panels. This works to equalize the pressure on both sides of the roof so it will not be forced up into the air. The wind can enter the stadium on one side and flow right out on the other side.
The wind comes into the stadium, but we actually release it out around gaps all around the stadium, and by doing so, we really reduce the pressure inside the building.
Then the individual panels are locked into place by hefty tie-downs. The 96 steel tie-downs can each withstand over 200,000 pounds of pressure, ensuring the roof panels stay locked solid in hurricane mode. A solution strong enough to convince even the most die-hard skeptics that this roof would stay on in a hurricane.
I definitely confirmed it and realized these are the best engineers in the world. And we looked and we talked and we studied and we went with what they said, and they turned out to be exactly right.
To my knowledge, this innovation has never been used before. This position where we actually crack the roof open in multiple areas has never been used on any stadium in the world.
Marlins Park's groundbreaking roof is engineered to be invincible in the face of some of the most destructive hurricane winds on the planet. This stadium will even be rock solid in the face of a Category 4 hurricane with winds of 146 miles per hour. But the team would only want to move the roof into hurricane mode when it was absolutely necessary, and is not a decision they would take lightly. They would need precise data on the weather before making a decision. The roof can be moved in gale force winds of 40 miles per hour, but if the wind were to get any stronger, the motors wouldn't be able to overcome the pressure on the roof's giant surface, and it would be too late to get into hurricane mode. The wind is just one of the many things the Marlins have to monitor 24/7. Claude Delorme is the executive vice president of operations and events.
So we're now at the command center, and you'll notice that as we go up to the command center where all the systems are controlled, for flooding purposes, we wanted to make sure that this room was above 10 feet.
The command center needed to be secure, as this would be where the call would be made to go into hurricane mode, and the only place in the stadium that would be occupied during a hurricane.
So as you can see in this area now, this is where every system in the building is controlled 24/7. Whether it's a game day or off day, this operation is open 7 days a week.
The constant stream of data from the command center allows Claude to make the call to go into hurricane mode at exactly the right time. If a cyclone over the Atlantic hits sustained winds of 40 miles per hour, Claude puts his team on red alert, primed to get the stadium hurricane ready at a moment's notice. If the storm then threatens to hit Miami, Claude will make the call to cancel any games and put the roof into hurricane mode.
One of the most critical rooms in the entire ballpark is right here, and we got to make sure that at all times this equipment is totally functional, because if we make a mistake here, there's repercussions all across the line.
Getting the roof into hurricane mode protects the roof and the stadium. But this stadium doesn't just need to save itself in a hurricane. There's a part of the building that could pose a risk to people living nearby. The thousands of square feet of glass that line this building could be shattered by debris in the hurricane winds. And the broken shards of glass would then be thrown around at lethal speeds. How could engineers ensure that their creation wouldn't add to the devastation of any hurricane? Everything about Marlins Park is state-of-the-art, and its retractable roof is a world first in hurricane-proof engineering. A strict hurricane lockdown protocol means the roof can withstand some of the most destructive winds on the planet. But the roof isn't the only part of the stadium that would be vulnerable in a storm. Hurricanes can send storm surges into Miami that threaten to tear buildings apart from their very foundations. And Marlins Park is smack bang in the middle of the worst floodplain. The stadium is less than 3 miles from the ocean and just south of the Miami River. Hurricanes can bring storm surge waters up the river that flood the land on either side. The water can reach as high as 9 feet above sea level. The cost of raising the whole stadium above the high watermark was too prohibitive, which meant the 27 entrances to Marlins Park were at risk in a flood. Jeff King, Vice President of Facilities at Marlins Park, is in charge of protecting the stadium.
Right now we're on the north side of the ballpark, and the elevation outside right now is about 7.5 feet above sea level. The Miami River is it's less than a mile to the north of us, and that would be the source of the floodwaters. The field itself is at elevation 6. If we get water in the field, then we've got a major issue on our hands.
If the waters from a storm surge into the stadium, the Marlins could find the field under 3 feet of water, and that would mean no baseball for a very long time. All the entrances must be protected to save the field and the stadium. And even in a high-tech building like Marlins Park, sometimes a low-tech solution can be the most cost-effective.
This is a floodgate. Again, we're at elevation about 7.5 here. Elevation, the flood level would be elevation 9, and then we're protecting 1 foot higher than what the flood elevation is.
These light but strong metal barriers can be installed in minutes, stopping the precious baseball field from being ruined in the face of even the largest predicted storm surge. But flood-proofing the stadium is only part of the story. There's one feature of the futuristic stadium that could threaten the people in the surrounding suburbs when a hurricane strikes. The ambitious design called for giant transparent walls. That meant a lot of glass, enough to cover 33 tennis courts. If this much glass is shattered by hurricane debris, the flying shards could act like shrapnel and endanger the lives of thousands of residents.
We're on the West Plaza, and as you can see, there's a lot of glass associated with this ballpark. When you look at the total square footage of the ballpark, we're talking 94,500 square feet. When you're dealing in an area where there's a lot of hurricanes and high winds, the element that's really critical is the debris.
The debris carried in high winds can be the most lethal part of a hurricane. Wood and tiles torn off houses can penetrate buildings like bullets. Engineers had to be sure the glass could withstand hurricane debris if they were to prevent a potential catastrophe.
The county was very concerned that one of the roofs, one of the residential homes, start taking off and it hits the glass, the building would be protected.
Miami's strict building codes required that the glass used at the stadium pass the toughest testing in the U.S.
It was called large missile testing, in which there was an air cannon 10 feet away that shot a 8-foot 2x4 into the glass at 60 miles per hour. And we wanted to see how the glass would react.
This test shows what would happen to normal glass when subjected to typical hurricane debris. With over 2 acres of potentially lethal glass, Marlins Park had to prevent this from happening.
We wanted to make sure if anything hit the glass, that the glass would withstand the winds and not become a flying object for the residential homes in our area. Everything was custom designed for this facility, and as a result, we needed to get that one-time approval.
The glass at Marlins Park is covered in impact sealant and constructed in layers to create 1-inch-thick, debris-proof sheets. The test would need to show that a flying 2x4 would not reduce this glass to thousands of deadly shards.
The glass was allowed to crack on the edges, but it was not able to penetrate. And once we passed that test, we were good to go.
The stadium's high-tech glass skin defines its iconic look and can withstand a hurricane's deadly missiles. Now the Marlins Park designers could use their toughened glass with confidence. They designed the ultimate picture window with a stunning view of downtown Miami.
And now we're looking at the operable wall. And there's six panels right now, and these will open on both sides to give us a spectacular view of downtown Miami. At night, we keep the operable wall open, and that allows the air circulation and makes a big difference to sustaining the quality of the grass. This is one of the largest operable walls you will see in professional sports.
The operable wall weighs 540,000 pounds, as much as a jumbo jet. With the wall open, the breeze can help feed the grass, but it also needs to shut out the very worst weather. And a hurricane will find even the smallest weakness in a building and destroy it.
When there's a hurricane, we will put it in a lockdown position, and we close the wall, make sure that we're not getting heavy rains, and then we'll lock it in from the time it becomes a named storm. We have six tie-down locations, so each panel, there's a rod that goes inside. It prevents the whole panel from any movement, so even if the winds get excessive, the six panels will remain in place.
Like the retractable roof, this wall is locked into safety mode when a hurricane approaches. Every aspect of the stadium is ready for the worst. Innovations from 100 feet below the ground to 200 feet in the air make this the cutting edge of extreme weather design. Even though it's directly in nature's firing line, Marlins Park faces the future with confidence. But how would the stadium fare when tested for the first time? The meticulously engineered Marlins Park is packed with technology to make it indestructible in the face of a hurricane. After 33 months of construction, the stadium opened on time and under budget for the first game of the 2012 season. But the Marlins' greatest threat is not in the major leagues, it's Florida's hurricane season. Just 5 months into the Marlins' first season in their new home, a storm over the Atlantic was intensifying at dangerous speed. It was called Tropical Storm Isaac.
On August 21st, Isaac went from a tropical wave, tropical depression, tropical storm during that same day. So we started really monitoring it.
Tropical Storm Isaac passed over Hispaniola and Cuba on the 24th of August, growing in size and strength, with winds of 65 miles per hour, threatening to build into a hurricane as it moved towards Florida.
The storm intensified, and at that point it was still a tropical storm, but was looking potentially as a Category 2 hurricane.
The Category 2 hurricane was strong enough to tear tiles off roofs and to damage windows. The Marlins had to get the stadium into hurricane mode. It was a huge operation.
Hurricane Isaac was the first time we really ended up going through all the motions of hurricane preparation. The unknown for us was how much time it would take us for the tie-down procedures.
Floodgates rose in all the vulnerable entrances. The operable wall was locked into place. And the roof was put into hurricane mode and tied down.
We put everything in a lockdown position from the roof to the wall. We started removing all the portables from the stands, removing everything. There were several operations taking place. It probably took a day and a half.
Tropical Storm Isaac changed course and went south of Florida. So Miami was only hit by outer winds of the storm system. But even without a direct hit, Isaac caused over $70 million of damage in Florida and left 11 counties as federal disaster areas. Marlins Park passed the only test nature had set it so far. But engineers calculated that with all its high-tech innovations, the stadium could have survived the two most destructive hurricanes in recent history, Katrina and Sandy. But could a hurricane hit that would be bigger and more destructive than anything recorded so far? One scientist at MIT theorizes that there is one set of dramatic conditions that could give rise to a monster hurricane. The trigger for this perfect storm? A giant asteroid impact. Hypothetically, the impact would heat ocean waters. This could feed a storm system. and lead to a hypercane 20 miles high with winds of 500 miles per hour and 60 foot tall surge waves. It's a controversial theory, and no stadium could withstand that kind of onslaught. For now, the designers of Marlins Park are confident they have built a stadium that will weather all but the most extreme storms.
For generations to come.
It was a wonderful project. It's one of a kind. When we first looked at the drawings and the plans, there's not one straight line in the artists and the architects, and it comes out, and they all appreciated because this is what their vision was. It's a great feeling. I think the intimacy of the ballpark, that you have 37,000 people as close as they are to the field and the game, I think is very unique.
This is a beautiful building. This is my fifth MLB stadium that I've constructed. Very proud of this structure, very proud of the men and the people who put in their time daily to build this building.
Well, now that the roof is finished, absolutely, it's a beautiful structure. Oh, it's a beautiful roof. It's my baby.
Marlins Park is the pinnacle of extreme weather engineering, the most hurricane-proof retractable roof system ever built, and an iconic addition to Miami's skyline. It's designed and built to be an indestructible megastructure.